بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم حديث 456 وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه في قصة المرأة التي كانت تقم المسجد فسأل عنها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقالوا ماتت فقال أفلا كنتم آذنتموني فكأنهم صغروا أمرهم فقال دلوني على قبرها فدلوه فصلى عليها متفق عليه وزاد مسلم ثم قال إن هذه القبور مملوءة ظلمة على أهلها وإن الله ينورها لهم بالصلاة عليهم. From Abu Huraira, talking about the story of a woman who used to sweep the masjid, the Prophet once asked about her and they replied, she died. And the Prophet said, why did you not inform me? And it was as if the companions did not see this woman to be of great significance or importance. So that's why they did not inform the Prophet. And the Prophet said, show me to her grave. So they showed him. And the Prophet went to the grave and prayed the janazah on her. Muttafaqun alayh, and Muslim adds that afterwards the Prophet said that these graves are filled with darkness. And Allah will put light in them because of my prayer over them. The ulama have said that in this hadith there is ittirab. They've said that this hadith is muttarib, which means that it has been reported in different wordings, which are contradictory. So some wordings of the hadith says that it was a man who would sweep the masjid, and other wordings of the hadith, like this one, say it was a woman. But the point is that this ittirab doesn't actually affect the authenticity of the hadith, because it doesn't actually matter whether it was a man or a woman, because the rulings of the hadith are the same. So this difference of wording doesn't actually affect the authenticity of the hadith, because it is not of central importance. And we have other examples as well, like the hadith of Fadala ibn Ubaid, when he bought a necklace with gold and other material for 12 dinar. And when he separated out the contents of the necklace, he found it to be worth more than 12 dinar of gold. So in this narration, the value of the gold in the necklace is differed upon. Some narrations say 12, and other narrations give different numbers. But we say that the value doesn't actually matter, because it is not of central importance, seeing as though the rulings which we take from the hadith are not going to be changed due to the changing value of the necklace. So this type of ittirab doesn't actually affect the authenticity of the hadith. We take from the hadith that during the time of the Prophet, the masajid used to be kept clean, as this woman would clean the masjid. And we have already taken the hadith, the statement of Aisha, where the Prophet ordered that the masajid be built in areas in which people are living, and that they should be cleaned and perfumed. And this will attract the people to come to the masjid. Nobody wants to attend a dirty or smelly masjid. And we also take that a woman can actually serve the masjid, just as we find in this case. This is on the condition that there is no fitna feared, so the woman should not put the men into trial. And we also learn the good character of the Prophet, in that if there was any one of his companions missing, the Prophet would notice. So he attached great importance to his companions, even somebody doing something like cleaning the masjid. And we may also take that the Prophet would love that somebody should clean the masjid, because when this woman was missing, the Prophet noticed her absence. So it is as if the Prophet would pay great attention to cleaning the masjid. We can take from the hadith that if you miss the Salat al-Janazah, then there is no problem in you going to the grave of the person and praying the janazah there. But this is on the condition that you had an excuse to miss the Salat al-Janazah. As for if you deliberately missed it, then it is not legislated for you to go to the grave and pray there. So here in this case, the Prophet missed it because he did not know. So he did not deliberately miss the Salat al-Janazah. Also, there is no problem in informing other people that a person has died. So you may want to inform the friends and family of a person that he has died, so they can join the Salat al-Janazah. And this is not an-na'i, which is prohibited. So an-na'i, which is prohibited, is that a person makes mention of the dead person and he enumerates his good feats and achievements in life. This is from the matters of the Jahiliyyah. As for simply informing the friends and family of the death of a person, then this is something that should be done, so you can have more people at the Salat al-Janazah. But the question now is, if you miss the prayer, you can go to the grave and pray the janazah. That's fair enough, but is there a time limit to this? So for example, could you go and pray the Salat al-Janazah at a grave of a person who lived 1,000 years ago? Can you go to the grave of the Prophet and pray Salat al-Janazah? Meaning to say, do we draw a line and give it a time limit? Some ulama say the time limit is 1 month. So if more than a month passes after the death of the person, you're not allowed to pray the Salat al-Janazah. And they use as the evidence that the Prophet prayed Salat al-Janazah 1 month after the death of someone. But we say that this is not something which the Prophet intended. It happened by chance. So things which happen by chance cannot be taken as law in the Sharia. Some people say you can pray the Salat al-Janazah as long as the body has not rotted away. So when the body, meaning the physical body, has rotted away, then you cannot. So upon this, you would have to see how long it would take for the body to rot away, and that would be your time limit. But there's a problem with this opinion as well, because when you pray the Salat al-Janazah, you're not praying it on the physical body. The body's dead, rather you're praying it for the soul of that body, because the soul lives on. And then what about a person dying and he's burnt to death, or perhaps a predator completely eats him up? Then he has no body. Does this mean you don't pray Salat al-Janazah over him? The answer is, of course not. So we say the answer to this question is, when the person died, if you were eligible to pray the Salat al-Janazah, so you were Muslim and Mukallaf, then you can go to his grave and pray the Salat al-Janazah after it has been officially prayed, if you missed it due to a valid reason. So if the person died and you were a Muslim but below the age of puberty and you missed the Salat al-Janazah, then it is not legislated for you to go to his grave after you reach the age of puberty and pray the Salat al-Janazah, because you were not from those people required to pray Salat al-Janazah, because you were under the age of puberty. And we can take from the fact that the Prophet is praying Salat al-Janazah that the Prophet himself does not have the ability to harm or benefit anyone. Rather, the Prophet himself needs to pray to Allah Jalla wa'ala to bring about benefit for the dead. We also take from this that the Prophet did not know the unseen, otherwise he would not be asking about this woman. Did the companions pray the Salat al-Janazah again, the second time round with the Prophet? This has not been reported, so we have to say no, they did not pray a second time round. Therefore, if you pray Salat al-Janazah once, you do not pray it again. In the same way, you don't pray Salat al-Dhuhr twice in one day. We find that these graves are full of darkness even for righteous people, because the Prophet is saying this hadith and he's in the grave of Al-Baqir, where the companions were buried. And we find that making dua for the dead will be the cause for their graves to be lit up. So we take the extremely important lesson to make dua for the dead Muslims and to pray the Salat al-Janazah. It will be a cause for Allah to lighten their grave. We also take from the hadith that you can mention something negative which has afflicted a people as long as you don't take it to a personal level. Because here the Prophet is saying that these graves are full of darkness for their inhabitants. Now the inhabitants of the grave do not want this information being leaked to other people because this is something negative. However, the Prophet is not talking about any one particular individual person. He's speaking on a general level. So if you speak it on a general level, then that's fine. But you should not do it on a personal level. Of course, we have the hadith in the Sahih about the Prophet passing by two graves, and he says that both of these inhabitants are being punished. One is being punished because he would go around with namima, and the other is being punished because he would not protect himself from his urine. And the hadith is well known. He took two branches and planted it, one each, on the grave. So clearly here, the Prophet is specifying the grave individually. So we can say this is something specific for the Prophet. Otherwise, there is no way we can know that the inhabitant of any particular grave is being punished, as clearly this is from the unseen. Can we take from this narration that Salatul Ghaib is legislated? A Ghaib is the one who is not present. So you pray the Salatul Janazah for the one who is not present. We say no, because the Prophet went to her grave and prayed. So she was actually Hadir, meaning her grave was in front of the Prophet. So it was not as if the Prophet is in another place and her grave is in another place and the Prophet is praying the Salat al-Janazah. No, rather, the Prophet went to her grave. Otherwise, the Prophet could have just prayed Salat al-Janazah in his home. Why did he need to go to her grave? So we say if you miss the Salat al-Janazah for a valid reason, then you need to go to the grave and pray it. And just praying it in your home is not sufficient, because this is what the Prophet could have done, but he didn't. And we know normally the Prophet would take the easier option. But in this case, he took the more difficult option. So we say you go to the grave and pray this Salat al-Janazah if you missed it due to a valid reason the first time round. Hadith 457. وعن حذيفة رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان ينهى عن النعي رواه أحمد والترمذي وحسن. From حذيفة, he says that the Prophet would forbid النعي. The hadith is Hasan. Hadith 458. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم نعى النجاشي في اليوم الذي مات فيه وخرج بهم إلى المصلى فصف بهم وكبر عليه أربعا متفق عليه. From Abu Huraira he says that the Prophet made a na'i of al-Najashi on the day he died, and with the people he went out to the musalla or the place of prayer, and he put the companions in rows and he prayed the Salat al-Janaza with four takbirat. Muttafaqun alayh. So firstly, let us understand this word al-Na'i. In the days of Jahiliyyah, when a person would die, somebody would go around in the markets and the streets publicly announcing his death, and he would enumerate the dead person's good qualities. So this is the na'i, which is forbidden, as it is from the aspects of the Jahiliyyah, which we are not allowed to imitate. But in the second narration, we find that the Prophet made a na'i of al-Najashi. Al-Najashi, the general title given to the king of Abyssinia in those days, was someone called a mukhadram. This is a person who accepted Islam during the time of the Prophet, but he never met the Prophet. So he was a Muslim, but not a companion during the time of the Prophet. So why did the Prophet make a na'i? We say this na'i which he made was simply announce al-Najashi's death, so that the people could pray Salat al-Janaza over him. It is not the same as the na'i of the Jahiliyyah, which is to go around announcing the death and enumerating the person's good qualities. This is an exaggeration with regards to the dead person. But as for announcing the death amongst the deceased's family and friends, then this is something which should be done, because you want their family and friends to pray the Salat al-Janaza. As for mentioning the good qualities of the dead person, then we find many books written by scholars who are speaking about the past classical scholars, and they enumerate their great qualities. So is this also not a na'i? We say no, this is not actually exaggerating with regards to the dead person, because this scholar has been dead for a very long time. Therefore, it is not likely at all that mentioning his good qualities would lead to people worshipping his grave or exaggerating at his grave, because he's been dead a long time. As for if he's newly dead and you start to mention his great qualities, then this could lead to people exaggerating in their praise for the dead person, and maybe even taking his grave as a place of worship or other actions which are deemed to be excessive in the Sharia, like building tombs and plastering the grave and over-venerating the grave. So the na'i which is forbidden is when you announce a person's death, so he's clearly newly died, and you enumerate his great qualities, and you do it very publicly. So if all these three conditions are met, then this is the na'i which is prohibited. Some scholars have said that this na'i, which the Prophet made for al-Najashi, is specific to the Prophet. We say no, the asl is that we follow the Prophet, both his statements and his actions. And we don't say anything is specific to the Prophet unless we have clear evidence. We can also take from this hadith the virtue of al-Najashi, in that the Prophet prayed Salat al-Janaza over him, as well as his companions. So clearly, this means that al-Najashi was a righteous man, and the Prophet called him a righteous man as well. And so therefore we find that Jibreel actually brought the news to the Prophet. So it shows the status of al-Najashi, that even Jibreel had to bring the news. And he's completely worthy of it, because look at the help he gave to the Muslims when some of them emigrated to Abyssinia. He gave them a place to live and he granted them protection from the harms of the mushrikeen. So he was clearly from the Ansar of this deen. Ansar, of course, meaning the helpers. And also he was a righteous man in a country which was a Christian country. So he was rare in his righteousness, because he was living amongst the non-Muslims. So if you can be righteous amongst the unrighteous people, then there is extra reward in this. And also authentically narrated from Amir ibn Shahr, he says that some of the Injil was recited to him, and he started to laugh at some of the verses of the Injil. And this was in Abyssinia, and at that time, al-Najashi was a Christian. And when Amir ibn Shahr laughed at some of the verses in the Injil, al-Najashi said to him, أَتَضْحَكُوا مِنْ كَلَامِ اللَّهِ? Are you laughing at the speech of Allah? So it clearly shows that even as a Christian, al-Najashi had great veneration for Allah Jalla wa Ala. It's just that he was following the wrong religion. And this is more than can be said about many kuffar nowadays. Not only are they kuffar, but they even question the existence of Allah Jalla wa Ala. They say he does not even exist, and that everything can be explained through scientific methods. So clearly these kuffar nowadays are far worse than the kuffar at the time of the Prophet. Far worse in terms of their beliefs and in terms of their actions. At least the mushrikeen at the time of the Prophet would turn to Allah Jalla wa Ala when they really needed him, like when they were sailing the seas. As for kuffar nowadays, then even in distressful circumstances, they still do not turn to Allah Jalla wa Ala. And it shows us the extent to which their fitrah has been ruptured. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. As for being righteous, when the people have become corrupt, the Prophet ﷺ said, بَدَأَ الْإِسْلَامُ غَرِيبًا وَيَعُودُ كَمَا بَدَأَ غَرِيبًا. Islam began as something strange, and it will return just as it started as something strange. فَطُوبَى لِلْغُرَبَى. So طُوبَى be to the strangers. And طُوبَى is a tree in Jannah. And when the Prophet was asked, who are these غُرَبَى? He replied, الَّذِينَ يَصْلُحُونَ إِذَا فَسَدَ النَّاسِ. Those who remain righteous when the people have become corrupt. We find in the hadith that the Prophet went to the Musalla. This could be the Musalla of the Salat al-Eid, or it could be a separate Musalla for the Salat al-Janazah. So either way is permissible. He put the companions into rows. We have a hadith in Sunan Abi Dawud that Allah will forgive a believer if three rows pray Salat al-Janazah over him. Now the hadith is da'if, but clearly Salat al-Janazah is prayed in rows just like the normal salawat. So because An-Najashi was in a Christian country, of course nobody prayed Salat al-Janazah over him, so it became obligatory upon the Muslims in Al-Madinah to pray Salat al-Janazah, because the Salat al-Janazah is a fardu kifaya. But this brings us to the issue of the Salat al-Ghaib, praying the Salat al-Janazah for the one who is not present, because clearly An-Najashi was not present in Al-Madinah. So is this allowed or not? Abu Hanifa and Malik say, it is not legislated. And they say that this situation in this hadith was specific to the Prophet. Al-Shafi'i and Ahmad, they say it is legislated, and they use this hadith as evidence. And they say this is not specific to the Prophet, because this claim that it is specific to the Prophet requires evidence. And there is none. From the scholars who said that it is legislated to pray the Salat al-Ghaib, they went to extremes and they said that before you go to sleep, pray Salat al-Janazah for all the Muslims who have died all around the world. But clearly this is a bid'ah. Because the Prophet had every reason to do this, and he did not do it, neither did he order it to be done. Some other scholars said that Salat al-Ghaib is permissible for a person who had great responsibility in this deen. Maybe he was a great scholar, or perhaps a leader of the Muslims. Somebody who had some influence, and really supported and strengthened this deen. So as a particular honoring for him, it is allowed to pray his Salat al-Ghaib. And they use this hadith as evidence because An-Najashi clearly had a big supporting hand for the Muslims. However, the best opinion out of all of this is, if the Salat al-Janazah has not been prayed over a certain Muslim, then and only then it is allowed to pray Salat al-Ghaib. So if a Muslim dies in another country, and it's a Kafir country, nobody has prayed over him, then if you, living in another country, find out about this death, then it is obligatory upon you to pray the Salat al-Janazah. And it makes no difference as to the status of this particular Muslim. As long as he's a Muslim and nobody has prayed over him, then it is obligatory for you to pray over him wherever you may be in the world, because Salat al-Janazah is fardu kifaya. And the evidence for this opinion is this hadith. We also take from the hadith that Salat al-Janazah is prayed with four takbirat. Hadith 459. وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول ما من رجل مسلم يموت فيقوم على جنازته 40 رجلا لا يشركون بالله شيئا إلا شفعهم الله فيه. رواه مسلم. From Ibn Abbas, the Prophet said, there is no Muslim man who dies, and 40 men not associating partners with Allah stand to pray his janazah, except that Allah will make these 40 men intercessors for the dead. Muslim reported it. So we notice from this hadith that the Prophet said, رَجُلٌ مُسْلِمٌ, a Muslim man, which basically means Salat al-Janazah is not to be prayed for a kafir man, nor woman. As for the evidence in the Qur'an, in Surah At-Tawbah, وَلَا تُصَلِّ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ مِّنْهُمْ مَاتَ أَبَدًا وَلَا تَقُمْ عَلَىٰ قَبْرِهِ إِنَّهُمْ كَفَرُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَمَاتُوا وَهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ. And do not pray over any one of them who dies nor stand at his grave. Verily they disbelieved in Allah and the Messenger, and they died whilst they were fasiqun. So this is talking about the hypocrites, but we can include all types of kuffar, because hypocrites are kuffar. The hadith uses the word rajul, which means man. Of course this includes woman, so the hadith cannot be taken at its literal face value. Rather, the ruling for a man is the same as a ruling for a woman, until we have evidence otherwise. He talks about 40 men praying on his janazah who don't associate partners. So this includes Shirk Akbar and Shirk Asghar. Shirk Asghar meaning taking an oath by other than Allah, or a little bit of showing off in your acts of worship, not the words little bit. The number 40 is used. Does this mean that if 39 men prayed, then Allah will not accept them as intercessors? The answer is no, Allah can still accept them as intercessors. So what's the point in using the number 40? We say the Prophet is encouraging many people to come to the Salat al-Janazah. So even if there are 20 people praying the Salat al-Janazah, Allah can still accept them as intercessors. The hadith talks about men praying the Salat al-Janazah. Does this mean women cannot pray? No, we say the Prophet used the word men because it is mainly the men who pray. Otherwise, women can also pray the Salat al-Janazah. And the Prophet used the word men because this is most often the case. And we also take that Salat al-Janazah is a means of intercession for the dead, because he says that Allah will accept them as intercessors. So when you're praying the Salat al-Janazah, in fact, you are interceding on behalf of the dead. Likewise, anytime you ask for forgiveness for the dead person, you are interceding on his behalf. And this is permissible and in fact recommended. We can take from the number 40 that you should try to get at least 40 people in the Salat al-Janazah. But if you're unable to do this, then it does not mean that your intercession will not be accepted. We have authentically in At-Tirmidhi, the Prophet was in a Salat al-Janazah, and in total there were 7 people. And the Prophet led the prayer, and he ordered the rest of the 6 people to stand in 3 rows. So there would be 2 people in each row. So there were 3 rows behind him, 2 in each row. But again, this narration is da'if. And the Imam is in front of the rows, he is not part of the front row. And this is a mistake which some people make. The Imam is in front of the row on his own, just like the normal prayers. Because in the narration, he had 3 rows behind him, and the word khalfa is used, which means behind him. As for the kafir, you do not pray Salat al-Janazah over him. Allah says, فَمَا تَنْفَعُهُمْ شَفَاعَةُ الشَّافِعِينَ. So the intercession of the intercessors will not benefit them. Neither do you visit the grave of the kuffar, because they don't deserve this honor. Actually, you do something which is quite the opposite. If you're passing by the cemetery of the kuffar, you give them glad tidings of the fire. Due to the statement of the Prophet, مَا مَرَرْتَ بِقَبْرِ كَافِرٍ فَبَشِّرْهُ بِالنَّارِ. Whenever you pass by the grave of a kafir, then give him glad tidings of the fire. Also, we take from the hadith the virtue of tawheed, in that if these 40 people are men of tawheed, so if they have not mixed the tawheed with any shirk, then Allah will accept them as intercessors. And all because of the virtue of tawheed. Hadith 460, وَعَنْ سَمُرَةَ بْنِ جُنْدُبٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ قَالَ صليت وراء النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم على امرأة ماتت في نفاسها فقام وسطها متفق عليه. From Samura ibn Jundub, he says that I prayed behind the Prophet in the janazah of a woman who had died in her postnatal bleeding, and the Prophet stood towards her middle. متفق عليه. So we take from this that the Salat al-Janazah is prayed as a normal prayer, in that the people are in rows behind the Imam and the Imam is in front of the rows. And we discussed this issue previously as well. But here Samura says that I prayed behind the Prophet. If the space is tight, then the Imam can be in the middle of the front row. But that's only if the space is tight. He mentions that this woman died in her nifas. This doesn't actually change the ruling. The point is that the Imam stands to the middle of the woman, whether she died in the nifas or not. One thing we do know about a woman dying in the nifas is that this type of woman is a shaheed. But that's a ruling for her in the hereafter, not in this world. So the only shaheed you do not pray the janazah for is the one who died in the battlefield. As for the other types of shuhada which we have mentioned, then you do pray Salat al-Janazah over them. And this is an example. Why did he stand to the middle of the woman? Some people say it is better at concealing the woman. But this is an unsatisfactory answer, because the person standing in the front row will easily be able to see the woman if he's standing to the right or the left of the Imam. Rather, we say this is just how the Prophet did it, so we follow him. So it is a ta'abbudi issue, an act of worship we don't know the reason behind. If many people have died, then you can pray one Salat al-Janazah over all of them. The janazah is going to be in front of the Imam, and the Imam needs to be facing the corpse. If a man and a woman are dead, then the man is closer to the Imam than the woman. If, let's say, they are all men, then the one who was most pious in his life is closer to the Imam, and the one who is least pious is further away. If they're equally pious, you go by age. The elder one is closer to the Imam. If a man is in front of you, the Imam stands facing the head of the man, and he stands facing the middle of the woman, so the corpses can be arranged appropriately. What about if a baby dies in the womb? If the baby had completed 4 months, then the soul has been blown into him, as we know from the authentic hadith, So in this case, he is treated like a normal person and he is prayed over. He is also named because he is going to be resurrected on Yawm al-Qiyamah. So he needs to be given a name because this is a name he will be called by. And also the aqiqah is performed on his behalf or her behalf. So you would wash him and shroud him and pray over him. And he will be buried in the Muslim cemetery, of course, if he is a child of the Muslim. If he is less than 4 months, then he's not treated as a normal human being because the soul has not been blown into him. So he's basically just flesh and bones. And the Salat al-Janazah is not prayed over flesh and bones, it is prayed over the soul. And seeing as though he does not have a soul, so he does not have a Salat al-Janazah. So in this case, he's simply to be buried in the ground. And that is it. As for the evidence that you stand facing the head of the man is in At-Tirmidhi where Al-Ala ibn Ziyad prayed over a man facing his head. And then he prayed over a woman facing the middle of her. And he says, this is how I saw the Prophet pray the Salat al-Janazah. Hadith 461. وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت والله لقد صلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم على ابني بيضاء في المسجد رواه مسلم. From Aisha, she says that, Wallahi, I saw the Prophet praying over the two sons of Bayda in the masjid. The names of these two sons, Sahal and Suhail. They are the children of Wahab ibn Rabi'ah. And their mother, Da'ad bint Jahdam, from the tribe of Banu Fahr. So, Al-Bayda is the title of their mother. We take from this narration that praying the Salat al-Janazah in the masjid is permissible, although this was not the regular practice of the Prophet. He would actually go out to the musalla and pray the janazah. Also we take it is permissible to take an oath when you are giving a fatwa, just as Aisha did here. She gave the ruling, but before that she said Wallahi. So you can take an oath without being asked for it, in order to emphasize an important matter. And it is not permissible to take an oath except for a matter which you are 100% sure of, or you are more than 50% sure. So it is predominant in your mind that the matter is as such. So there you can take an oath. Aisha says here that the Prophet prayed over the two sons of Bayda, and this is the mother. But shouldn't the children be ascribed to the father, who was Wahab ibn Rabi'ah? We say it is permissible to ascribe the children to the mother, as long as this will not interfere with the lineage of the children. And Allah Jalla wa Ala says, أُدْعُوهُمْ لِآبَائِهِمْ هُوَ أَقْسَطُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. Ascribe the children to their father's name. This is more just with Allah. So you can ascribe the children to the mother, as long as this will not wipe out the relation of the children to their father, such that the children will only be known by their mother. That is wrong. Because if this happens, then people will start to think that this child is a child of zina. Because only a child of zina is ascribed to his mother. He cannot be ascribed to the father, because in the Sharia, he's not actually the child of the father. Although he is his child biologically, but not in the Sharia. Hadith 462. وعن عبد الرحمن ابن أبي ليلى قال كان زيد بن أرقم رضي الله عنه يكبر على جنائزنا أربعا وأنه كبر على جنازة خمسا فسألته فقال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يكبرها رواه مسلم والأربعة. وعن علي رضي الله عنه أنه كبر على سهل بن حنيف ستا وقال إنه بدري رواه سعيد بن منصور وأصله في البخاري. From عبد الرحمن ابن أبي ليلى, he says that Zayd ibn Arqam would pray the Salat al-Janazah and he would make 4 takbirat. And once he made 5 takbirat, and I asked him about this and he said that the Prophet used to do this, meaning 5 takbirat. Muslim and the 4 Sunan reported it. And from Ali, it is narrated that he prayed over Sahal ibn Hunayf, the Salat al-Janazah, and he made 6 takbirat. And he said, commenting on this, that this man, meaning Sahal ibn Hunayf, fought at the Battle of Badr. The narration is Sahih. Hadith 463. وعن جابر رضي الله عنه قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يكبر على جنائزنا أربعا وَيَقْرَأُ بِفَاتِحَةِ الْكِتَابِ فِي التَّكْبِيرَةِ الْأُولَى رَوَاهُ الشَّافِعِي بِإِسْنَادٍ ضَعِيفٍ. From Jabir, he says that the Prophet would make 4 takbirat in the Salat al-Janazah and he would recite the Fatiha after the first takbir. The narration is ضعيف. Hadith 464. وعن طلحة بن عبد الله بن عوف رضي الله عنه قال صليت خلف ابن عباس على جنازة فقرأ فاتحة الكتاب فقال لتعلموا أنها سنة. رواه البخاري. From Talha ibn Abdullah ibn Auf, he says that I prayed behind Ibn Abbas in the Salat al-Janaza, and he recited, meaning recited out aloud, Fatihatul Kitab, and he said, in order that you may know it is a sunnah. Al-Bukhari reported it. So these narrations are talking about the description of the Salat al-Janaza. And different numbers of takbirat are mentioned, and they're all permissible. As for the actions of Zayd ibn Arqam, we are told that he would make 4 takbirat, and once he made 5. And he said this is how the Prophet did it. So we can take that the Tabi'een were eager to seek knowledge, because here Abdurrahman ibn Abi Layla is asking Zayd ibn Arqam why he made 5 takbirat instead of 4. And this is because 5 takbirat were unusual, they were used to 4. So when something unusual happened, they would ask about it. Similarly, when Dhul Yadayn asked the Prophet why he prayed only 2 rak'at, has the prayer been shortened or have you forgotten? And we can also take that you can teach the people the sunnah just by your actions, without actually verbally instructing them. Just as Zayd ibn Arqam did here, he physically performed 5 takbirat to teach the people that this is also part of the sunnah. 4 takbirat are narrated from the Prophet when he prayed over al-Najashi, but also from the companions we have 5, 6, 7, 8 and even up to 9 takbirat mentioned. So therefore we can say the issue is flexible, all of them are permissible. But there is a difference between what should be done regularly and what is permissible to be done. What should be done regularly is the 4 takbirat. And particularly if you're praying and leading people who are ignorant of this deen, and all they know is 4 takbirat, and if you were to increase, then this could cause fitna amongst them, and they may think that you are doing something wrong. So you need to take this into account, and therefore in order to keep yourself away from the fitna, just do 4. As for if you're leading people who are knowledgeable, and hence they are open-minded, then there's no problem if you increase the number of takbirat. Because the people behind you, due to their knowledge and understanding, will be able to figure out why you did what you did. But it's just that people who are ignorant are often narrow-minded, and they believe that their opinion is the only opinion that's going. So as for if you do something which is not familiar with the people, then you should make it plain to them. Similarly, if an imam is leading the prayer and he recites a recitation which the people are not familiar with, then he should make it known to them that he is reciting a different recitation. Otherwise, many people may start to think that he is reciting the Qur'an wrong. Also, we have said before that the imam stands in front of the congregation, not in the middle of the front row. And we've taken this clearly from the narration which we quoted from At-Tirmidhi, where the Prophet lined 3 rows, 2 in each row, and he led them, and he was in front of them. And Nawawi says that there was a difference of opinion amongst the Sahaba as to how many takbirat there were. And then afterwards this difference vanished and they all agreed that there are 4 takbirat in the Salah. And definitely this is what the Prophet would most often do. There is an opinion amongst the scholars that if the Imam does more than 4 takbirat, then you do not follow him in that. Though this does seem a little strict, especially when we have evidences from Zayd ibn Arqam who made 5 takbirat and Ali ibn Abi Talib who made 6 takbirat on Sahal ibn Hunayf. So if the evidence is there, then it's difficult to say that you should not follow the imam if he makes more than 4 takbirat. It appears that Ali made 6 takbirat and he justified it by saying that he was present at the Battle of Badr. So it appears Ali is giving him more honor, due to the fact that he was at the Battle of Badr. It's worth knowing that in total we have 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 and even up to 9 takbirat reported in the narrations. The narration of Jabir tells us that you recite Surat al-Fatiha, even though that narration is da'if, but we know that the Salat al-Janaza is a salah, and the Prophet said that there is no prayer for the one who does not recite the Fatiha. So we find that after the first takbir, which is the opening takbir, you recite Surat al-Fatiha. And this is because the Salat al-Janaza is a dua for the dead. And whenever you make dua for the dead, you need to begin by praising Allah Jalla wa'ala and sending the Salah on the Prophet. So this is exactly what you do. After the first takbir, you say the Fatiha, which is essentially sending praise upon Allah. And then after the second takbir, you send the Salah upon the Prophet by saying Allahumma salli ala Muhammad up until the end of it. And this is the manner of making dua. The Salat al-Janaza is a silent prayer and not a loud one. Ibn Abbas recited al-Fatiha out aloud to teach people that this is the sunnah. So again, we have this idea of teaching people by performing actions rather than giving them verbal instructions. And when he says sunnah, it does not mean mustahab. Rather, it means that it is from the way of the Prophet. We have other evidences to say that it is from the arkan of the salah. Then after the third takbir, you make the dua for the dead, and the legislated dua is coming up. Then you make the fourth takbir, and you stay silent for a little while, and then you make the taslim. The issue here is, do you raise your hands with the takbirat or not? There's a difference of opinion. We don't have anything authentic from the Prophet that he raised the hands. Though we do have the narration of Ibn Umar, it has been reported that he used to raise his hands for the takbirat of the Salat al-Janazah. So if you raise your hands, there's no problem. And if you don't raise your hands, then this is also an acceptable opinion. Because the narration of Ibn Umar raising his hands is questionable, as many have graded it to be da'if. Do you recite the dua al-istiftah before the Fatiha? Majority of the scholars say no, you don't, because this Salat al-Janazah is based upon lightening of the load. It is not like the full prayer with the ruku' and the sujood. So you do not make the istiftah. When you make the taslim, majority of the scholars say it is one taslim on the right. However, we do have evidence which tells us that you can make taslim on the right and on the left. The evidence for two taslims is found in Al-Bayhaqi, which is the narration of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. And the evidence for one taslim is also found in Al-Bayhaqi. It is the narration of Abu Hurairah, who says that the Prophet made four takbirat and one taslim. In another wording of the narration of Ibn Abbas, he says, I only recited the Fatiha out aloud so that you would know it is sunnah. So this would tend to suggest that normally you don't recite it out aloud. And before reciting the Fatiha, it is recommended to say the ta'awudh and the basmala, just as in the normal salah. But it's just the dua al-istiftah is not to be said, because Salat al-Janazah is meant to be a light prayer. And some of the ulama have said that Surat al-Fatiha in the Salat al-Janazah is mustahab and not wajib. This is the opinion of Abu Hanifa and Malik. And also Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn al-Qayyim are of this opinion. But we say it is safest to always recite al-Fatiha, due to the generality of the hadith, La salata liman lam yaqra' bi fatihatil kitab. There is no salah for the one who does not recite fatihatul kitab. And Salat al-Janazah is a salah. What happens if you join the prayer late and you miss some of the takbirat? You do as you would do when you join any other prayer late. You begin the prayer, and so your first takbir will be your first takbir. When the imam finishes, then it is upon you to finish the prayer before the janazah in front of you is taken away. Because the idea is that the janazah should be in front of you as you are praying. You don't pray and there's no janazah in front of you. So if you fear that they will take it away immediately, then you can recite the recitations in shortened format. So firstly, you'll recite Al-Fatiha, which is fine. When it comes to the second takbir, you need to send the salah upon the Prophet. So you can easily just say, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, and just leave it at that. Because there, you've sent the salah on the Prophet, even though you have not said it fully. And then after the next takbir, you make a quick dua for the dead. So even if you just say, Allahumma ghafirlah, O Allah forgive him, this would suffice, because this is in fact a dua, even though you have not said the recommended dua, which has been reported, which is something which we're moving on to in a short while. But the point is, you made dua for the dead. And then you make your fourth takbir, then you remain silent a few seconds, then you make the taslim, either once or twice as we said before. And all of this can easily be done before the janazah is removed. And even if the janazah is removed before you have a chance to complete your prayer, then there is no problem in you breaking the prayer off when the janazah is removed, because the salat al-janazah is fardu kifaya. So as long as somebody has done it, then the obligation is removed. So you are not actually required anymore to complete the prayer, which is different to if you join the salat al-isha late. There you have to complete the prayer, because salat al-isha, just like the other five prayers, is fardu ayn, not fardu kifaya. So there's the difference. Hadith 465. وعن عوف بن مالك رضي الله عنه قال صلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم على جنازة فحفظت من دعائه اللهم اغفر له وارحمه وعافه واعف عنه وأكرم نزله ووسع مدخله واغسله بالماء والثلج والبرد ونقه من الخطايا كما ينقى الثوب الأبيض من الدنس وأبدله دارا خيرا من داره وأهلا خيرا من أهله وأدخله الجنة وقه فتنة القبر وعذاب النار رواه مسلم. From Auf ibn Malik, he says that the Prophet prayed the Salat al-Janazah and he memorized the following dua from him. And he goes on to narrate the dua. Hadith 466. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا صلى على جنازة يقول اللهم اغفر لي حينا وميتنا وشاهدنا وغائبنا وصغيرنا وكبيرنا وذكرنا وأنثانا اللهم من أحييته منا فأحيه على الإسلام ومن توفيته منا فتوفه على الإيمان اللهم لا تحرمنا أجره ولا تضلنا بعده رواه مسلم والأربعة. From Abu Huraira, he says that the Prophet prays Salat al-Janazah and he would make this dua, and he goes on to narrate the dua. Al-Hafidh says that Muslim reported it. This is a mistake. Muslim did not report this narration. Rather, it is found in the four Sunan. Hadith 467. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إذا صليتم على الميت فأخلصوا له الدعاء رواه أبو داود وصححه ابن حبان. From Abu Huraira, the Prophet said, when you pray over the dead, then make sincere dua for him. The hadith is Hasan. So all of these three narrations talk about the dua you make for the janazah. Really, you can make any dua you want, but it is better to use the dua which have been narrated by the Prophet. Otherwise, the idea is to make dua for the dead. So let's go through this first dua which we have mentioned, and this is found in Muslim. He says, Allahumma ghafir lah. Oh Allah, forgive him. If it's a woman, you would say, Allahumma ghafir laha. So the pronoun needs to be changed, of course. And the same rule applies all across the board. Whenever you have a male pronoun, if it is a woman, then you would change it to the female pronoun. And if there are multiple janazah that you're praying over, then you would say, Allahumma ghafir lahum. So you would use the plural pronoun, because clearly there's a difference between him, her, and them. Warhamhu, and have mercy on him. So with the forgiveness, you are asking for his sins to be removed and not be taken to account for them. And with the mercy, the rahmah, you are asking for goodness to come upon him. So the pleasure of Allah and the reward of Allah Jalla wa Ala. So you ask for the removal of something which is negative, and then after you ask for that which is positive. In the same way, if you want to clean your room, you would remove the rubbish first, and thereafter you would decorate it. وَعَافِهِ وَعَفُ عَنْهُ And grant him well-being. Well-being from his sins, and from the punishment of the grave and of Jahannam. وَعَفُ عَنْهُ Meaning overlook him. As in overlook his sins and his faults. So anything wrong which he did, overlook that. And if he missed out on anything which is wajib upon him, then overlook that. وَأَكْرِمْ نُزُلَهُ And give him a goodly provision. Nuzul is something which you give to the guest. So when a guest arrives at your house, you give him a nuzul, which is the food you present to the guest. So this is what you're asking Allah. Give him a noble nuzul. Because the dead person is like a guest in the grave. He's not going to stay there forever. So you're asking Allah to grant him a goodly provision. وَوَسِّعْ مَدْخَلَهُ And expand his place of entry. This is the grave we're talking about, so expand his grave. So if he's a righteous person, he will find his grave to be expanded, and he will sleep with ease. But if he's an evil person, his grave will become constricted upon him and will crush him. Likewise, if he's a righteous person, a window of Jannah will be opened for him, and he will also be shown his place in Jannah, which will be his final destination. وَغَسِلْهُ بِالْمَاءِ وَالثَّلْجِ وَالْبَرَدِ And wash him with water and ice and hailstone. This is because when you commit sins, the effect is that you go to Jahannam, which is hot. So you're asking Allah to wash his sins with the complete opposite of the heat of the fire, which is water and ice and hailstone. وَنَقِّهِ مِنَ الْخَطَايَا كَمَا يُنَقَّى الثَّوْبُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الدَّنَسِ And cleanse him from his sins, just as the white clothing is cleansed from the dirt. So you can take a look at the pure white clothing, you will not find a speck of dirt. So you're asking Allah to make his record of deeds just like this plain white pure clothing, not even a speck of dirt on it. وَأَبْدِلْهُ دَارًا خَيْرًا مِنْ دَارِهِ And exchange for him a house better than his house in this world. Obviously, your place in Jannah is far better than your place in this world, no matter how much a luxury life he lived. وَأَهْلًا خَيْرًا مِنْ أَهْلِهِ And a family better than his family in this world. Does this mean you're asking him for a new family? No, It could still be the same family, but they are themselves changed. So when you exchange something, you can exchange A for B, so they're two different things, or you can change A itself. So A becomes a new and improved version of the old A. So this is the idea. And this is why he goes on to say in the original version of Muslim, and not reported here in Bulugh al-Maram, وَزَوْجًا خَيْلًا مِنْ زَوْجِ, and a wife better than his wife. This does not mean a new wife, rather you will be with your wife in this world, in Jannah as well. But she will be a better woman, with a better character, and more beautiful, and more pure, because she will not menstruate. We find in the Qur'an that Allah Jalla wa Ala changed the wife of Zakariya, so she was able to give birth to his son Yahya. We find in Surah Al-Anbiya, Allah Jalla wa Ala says, فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ وَوَهَبْنَا لَهُ يَحْيَى وَأَصْلَحْنَا لَهُ زَوْجَهُ إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا يُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْخَيْرَاتِ وَيَدْعُونَنَا رَغَبًا وَرَهَبًا وَكَانُوا لَنَا خَاشِعِينَ. So we answered his call, and we granted him Yahya, and we rectified his wife for him. So she was able to give birth, up until the end of the ayah. So his wife was the same woman, but she became better, in that she was now able to give birth. Likewise, on Yawm al-Qiyamah, Allah Jalla wa Ala will change this earth. He says, يَوْمَ تُبَدَّلُ الْأَرْضُ غَيْرَ الْأَرْضِ وَالسَّمَاوَاتِ, the day when the heavens and the earth will be changed. So it will still be the same earth, but it will be changed. It will not look like as it is looking like now. One might ask at this stage, what if this person was not married? How can we ask a better wife for him than the one he had in this world, if he did not have a wife in this world? So the way we could interpret this then is to say, oh Allah, grant him a better wife in the hereafter than his wife in this world, if he had a wife in this world. So whatever type of wife he could have had in this world, give him something better in the hereafter. وَأَدْخِلْهُ الْجَنَّةَ, and enter him into Jannah. Jannah in the Arabic language means a garden with densely growing trees, although we shouldn't try to visualize what Jannah will be like in the hereafter. All we know is Jannah is a place which no eye has seen, no ear has heard, and the thought of it has never occurred to anyone. As for all the descriptions that you find in the Ahadith and the Qur'an, then these are merely words. There's no way you can imagine how they will look like. In the same way with the descriptions of Allah Jalla wa Ala, when it comes to his eye, his foot, his hand, these are merely words which you understand. There is no way you can imagine how they look like. In Bulugh al-Maram, it goes on to say, وَقِهِ فِتْنَةَ الْقَبْرِ, but this is not found in Muslim, rather we find in Muslim, وَأَعِذْهُ مِنْ عَذَابِ الْقَبْرِ, and give him protection from the punishment of the grave. And so with this we find that the grave will have a punishment. And this is different to the fitna of the grave. The fitna of the grave is when you ask the questions by the two angels. And it doesn't actually make sense to say, and save him from the fitna of the grave, because everybody will be faced with the fitna of the grave. There's no way you can escape the questioning. Except, of course, the shaheed in the battlefield. So these people are not questioned, but as for everyone else, they are questioned. So there's no way you can be saved from the fitna of the grave. And the Prophet said, إِنَّكُمْ تُفْتَنُونَ فِي قُبُورِكُمْ مِثْلَ فِتْنَةِ الدَّجَّالِ, you will be tested in your graves, just like the severity of the test or the trials of Ad-Dajjal. So the wording which we find in the original version is better, giving protection from the punishment of the grave. So with this, there is proof that the grave will have punishment. And in the Sahih, the Prophet said that if it wasn't for the fact that you would stop burying your dead, I would make dua to Allah to make you hear the punishment of the grave. So the punishment of the grave is real, and you'd better believe it. As for the evidence that the shaheed will not be tested or put to trials in the grave, the authentic narration in An-Nasa'i, the Prophet was asked, Ya Rasulullah, مَا بَعْلُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ يُفْتَنُونَ فِي قُبُورِهِمْ إِلَّا الشَّهِيدِ, O Messenger of Allah, what is it with the believers that they will be tried in their graves except the shaheed? And the Prophet said, كَفَى بِبَارِقَةِ السُّيُوفِ عَلَى رَأْسِهِ فِتْنَةً, it is enough of the shining of the swords on his head as a fitna or a trial. So this is the fitna he faces on the battlefield. So a person who has to face this type of trial on the battlefield, it is only fitting that as a reward he should not face the trial in the grave. And from this we can also take that the Prophet does not have the ability to benefit us, rather he himself needs Allah to call upon so that Allah could benefit us in our graves. Of course, when it says punishment of the grave, what it actually means is punishment of the barzakh, as not everybody is buried in a grave. But the punishment is upon the soul, not on the physical body. As for if you're a righteous person, then you will have nothing to fear with respect to the trial of the grave. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, يُثَبِّتُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِالْقَوْلِ الثَّابِتِ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ وَيُضِلُّ اللَّهُ الظَّالِمِينَ وَيَفْعَلُ اللَّهُ مَا يَشَاءُ. Allah will keep firm those who believe with the firm word in this world and in the hereafter. And Allah sends astray the wrongdoers, and Allah does what He wants. وَعَذَابِ النَّارِ, and the punishment of the fire. So in this there is evidence that there is a hellfire, and we ask Allah protection from it. As for the second dua, this is also authentic, found in the Sunan. Allahumma ghafir li hayyina. O Allah, forgive those of us who are living. Wa mayyitina, and those of us who are dead. And this is as Allah Jalla wa Ala recommends us to say in Surah Al-Hashr, وَالَّذِينَ جَاءُوا مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لَنَا وَلِإِخْوَانِنَا الَّذِينَ سَبَقُونَا بِالْإِيمَانِ وَلَا تَجْعَلْ فِي قُلُوبِنَا غِلًّا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا رَبَّنَا إِنَّكَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. And those who came after them, they said, Our Lord, forgive us and our brothers who have passed before us in Iman. And do not put in our hearts any rancor for those who believe. Our Lord, You are the One full of pity and mercy. وَشَاهِدِنَا وَغَائِبِنَا وَصَغِيرِنَا وَكَبِيرِنَا. And those of us who are present, those of us who are not present, the young amongst us, the elderly amongst us, وَذَكَرِنَا وَأُنْثَانَا, the male of us and the female of us. One might ask at this stage, why is he detailing it out in this way? We say that dua is when you have a private consultation with Allah, and it's an act of worship. So if you can lengthen this dua, it means you are lengthening your consultation with Allah and you are lengthening the ibadah. And also it shows that you are desperate in seeking what you are trying to seek, that you will go to great lengths in detailing out your dua. So it shows that you are really desperate and needy of Allah Jalla wa Ala. Allahumma man ahyaytahu minna fa'ahyihi ala al-Islam. O Allah, whomsoever you give life to from us, then let him live upon Islam. And this is because when you are living, you're performing physical actions. So your physical actions need to be in accordance with Islam. And remember, when we say Islam and Iman together, then Islam are your physical outward actions, and your Iman are your inner beliefs. So when you're living, you're performing physical actions, so this is more pertaining to Islam. وَمَنْ تَوَفَّيْتَهُ مِنَّا فَتَوَفَّهُ عَلَى الْإِيمَانِ. And whomsoever you make to die from amongst us, then make him die upon Iman. So notice here the word Iman is used and not Islam. This is because when you're dying, you're not actually performing any physical actions. So the only thing left now is your conviction in your heart, and this is your Iman. So when Islam and Iman are used together, then Iman are your inner beliefs in the heart, and your Islam are your outward actions. Otherwise they mean the same thing if they are just left on their own. Allahumma la tahrimna ajra. O Allah, do not deprive us of His reward. So this would be the reward of preparing the corpse by washing it and shrouding it and praying over it and following the funeral procession. All of these are reward worthy. So do not deprive us of this reward. And also for us keeping patient over his death. This is also reward worthy, so do not deprive us of this reward. As for if we understand the words his reward to be the reward of his actions, meaning the dead person's actions, then there's no way we can seek that reward. That reward is for him, because whoever performs a righteous action, then he and he alone deserves that reward. So for us to ask for that reward would be at-ta'addi in the dua. At-ta'addi meaning when you overstep the limit and you transgress. وَلَا تُضِلَّنَا بَعْدَ. And do not misguide us after him. As long as you are alive, there's every chance that you can be misguided. So you need to ask Allah Jalla wa Ala to keep you firm upon this deen. There are two types of trials which can mislead you. The fitna of the shahwa, which is the trial of desires, which pulls you away from the sharia. And then you have the fitna of the shubuha, the trial of the specious arguments. These sound like Islamic arguments, but actually they are deviant arguments. And this is where all the deviant factions of Islam have gone astray, mainly because of these specious arguments. They believe it to be in accordance with the Quran and the Sunnah, but in actuality, it is a misguidance and opposes the Sunnah of the Prophet. So seek protection from shahwa and shubuha. Of course, we have the small but effective dua, Ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik. O turner of the hearts, keep my heart firm on your deen. And if you look at all these people who are upon misguidance, they actually do believe in their heart that they are upon guidance. In Surah Al-A'raf, Ayah 30, فَرِيقًا هَدَى وَفَرِيقًا حَقَّ عَلَيْهِمُ الضَّلَالَةِ إِنَّهُمُ اتَّخَذُوا الشَّيَاطِينَ أَوْلِيَاءَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ وَيَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. A group he guided and a group deserved to be in error. Verily, they took the shayateen as allies besides Allah, and they used to think that they are rightly guided. Likewise, Surah Al-Kahf, Ayah 103, قُلْ هَلْ نُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِالْأَخْسَرِينَ أَعْمَالًا. Say, shall we tell you of the greatest losers in respects to their deeds? الَّذِينَ ضَلَّ سَعْيَهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ يَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ يُحْسِنُونَ صُنْعًا. Those whose efforts have been wasted in this life, whilst they thought that they were doing good. So the point is, with this dua, you're asking Allah not to misguide you after him. And we know after the righteous people, only the useless people will be left, and there will be no good in them, and upon them, Yawm al-Qiyamah will be established. As for the third hadith, which gives the order to make sincere dua for the dead, then making sincere dua for him means specifying him individually in your dua. And making dua for the dead in the Salat al-Janazah is wajib because the order has been given here in this hadith. So even if you said something like, Allahumma ghafir lah, oh Allah, forgive him, then you've specified him in the dua, and this would suffice. And you have done what is wajib upon you. And remember, we said this idea of making dua for the dead in the Salat al-Janazah is flexible. You can make any dua for him. Although, like we said before, the reported dua is better. Can the dua be made in English if you don't know the Arabic? The answer, as always, is yes. Of course, when it comes to the Qur'an, this cannot be given the English translation. The Qur'an must be recited in Arabic, so Surah al-Fatiha must be recited in Arabic. And the dua is better to be said in Arabic because it is more accurate. However, some people may not know the Arabic. Hence, for them to make dua in their language is permissible, simply because there's no evidence to say it is not permissible. And the Prophet has ordered us to make dua. He did not order us to make dua in the Arabic language. The ulama have said that the most authentic duas for the dead which have been reported are these two which we have quoted in Bulugh al-Maram. Such that when Auf ibn Malik heard the Prophet say this dua, he wished that he was the dead person, because that's how powerful he felt this dua was. What about an infant when he dies? If 4 months have been completed, so the soul has been blown in, then Salat al-Janazah is to be prayed upon him. And we have mentioned this ruling before. The evidence for this authentically reported in Al-Bayhaqi, the Prophet said, As-siqtu yusalla alayhi wa yud'a li walidayhi bil maghfirati wal rahmati wal afiyah. The aborted fetus is to be prayed upon, and dua is made for his parents that they should have forgiveness and mercy and well-being. As for if the mother miscarries and she's bleeding, then you have to look that if 81 or more days have passed, then if the baby has features of a human being, then this bleeding is nifas. If he does not have features of a human being, after 81 days or more that is, then this bleeding takes the same ruling as istihaba, and the woman does pray and fast, and she makes wudu for every prayer. And the ruling on nifas is the same as hayd, and we spoke about this topic in the chapter of tahara. As for any reported du'as for a child who has died before reaching the age of puberty, then there are some du'as which have been reported, and you should be able to find them in any decent du'a book. Some people have said that after the fourth takbir, you say, رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. However, we don't know of any authentic evidence for this. So it's better you remain quiet for a few seconds and then make the taslim. Hadith 468. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أسرعوا بالجنازة فإن تكوا صالحة فخير تقدمونها إلي وإن تكوا سوى ذلك فشر تضعونه عن رقابكم. متفق عليه. From Abu Huraira, the Prophet said, hurry with the janazah, because if it is a righteous person, you are delivering him to goodness, and if he is other than that, then it is only evil you are removing from your necks. متفق عليه. So when he says hurry, he means don't waste any time in washing the body and putting the kafan on and the salah and taking it to the grave and the burial. Although the end part of the hadith would suggest that the Prophet is talking about when you're carrying the janazah to the grave, because he says that if it is righteous, you are delivering him to goodness, and if it is other than that, then you are taking evil off your necks. However, we say, because the first part of the hadith is general, we take it on its generality. So it includes not only the funeral procession, but also the other things which you do to prepare the janazah. It includes everything because the first part of the hadith is general.
In the Sunan, we also have that Abu Bakr reports, saying we were with the Prophet in the funeral procession, and we were almost making ramal, carrying the janazah. Ramal is this light form of jogging which people do around the Kaaba for the first three laps, also between the two green markers between the Safa and Marwa. So they were almost doing ramal. In other words, they were definitely hurrying up with the funeral procession and walking fairly briskly.
Notice how the Prophet says that if it was other than that, then you are removing evil from your necks. He doesn't say, as for if this person was a wicked person, then it is evil you are removing from your necks. This is because the Prophet wants to use better terms. And he's avoided saying that you are taking this janazah to some place evil. Because it is not fitting to say that you are taking a Muslim to an evil place. Even though if the person was an evil person, then clearly he's going to be punished in the grave. So it is an evil place you're taking him to, but the Prophet does not deem it fit to say regarding a Muslim that you're taking him to an evil place. So clearly he's taking care of how he expresses himself. And we take from this hadith that the Prophet is a sincere well-wisher to the Ummah, because he's giving them noble advice. And also a good teaching technique, he gives them the ruling and the reasoning behind the ruling, so as to put the hearts at rest. Also we take from the narration the punishment and pleasure of the grave, depending on whether you are righteous or evil. As for when you are carrying the janazah, then you certainly do not rush. You walk at a leisurely pace, because running will make you tired, and this is against the sunnah. And as for deliberately walking slowly, step by step, as you see the kuffar doing, then this is a bid'ah. Rather, you just walk as normal. And neither do you raise your voice in this procession. Rather, this is a time of reflection.
We also have authentically in the Sunan, the Prophet said, "Al-raqib khalf al-janaza wal-mashi haythu sha'ah wa-t-tiflu yusalla alayhi." The one riding an animal, he rides behind the janaza, and the pedestrian may walk wherever, in front, behind, left, right, and the child is prayed over. And it is better to have the horse rider behind the janaza, because if the horses were in front of the janaza, then the horses may feel anxious and become startled with the janaza procession behind them. So it's better that the horses are behind, so they can see what is in front of them.
Is it permissible to delay with the janazah preparations? The answer is yes, if it is for a need. For example, if the person has been murdered and they need to carry out an autopsy for the investigation, then this is a permissible need. As for using the dead corpse to carry out some medical research, then this is not to be done with a Muslim, rather it can be done with a corpse of a kafir, because the Muslim has honor even after his death. And also, if you hold back the Muslim from burying him, then if he is righteous, then this is actually a harm you are performing on him. And it is a transgression, because he wants to go to his grave. So he wants you to hurry up with the janazah procession. So you holding him back is actually a transgression against him.
Let's take some review questions. Question number one. Give the detail about praying the Salat al-Janazah if you have missed it. And what is the time limit? Question number two. Give the definition and ruling of an-na'i, and which form is halal and which form is haram. Question number three, give the detail on praying over the fetus.